So with this background, let's look at the market basket model more formally. You are given a large set of items. So for example, the set of items could be all the items that are sold in a supermarket store. So these could be tens of thousands of items. And in each transaction, the customer is going to purchase only a small number of these items. The set of items that are part of each transaction is called a basket. So a basket is just a small subset of the items among the total number of items that are available in the store. So a basket could be all the things that the customer puts into his or her shopping basket on one single day. So think of a basket as just corresponding to a transaction and as containing a set of items that are available in the store. Now, given a set of baskets, we want to discover association rules between products. So for example, we want to discover rules like people who bought items X, Y, and Z also tend to buy item V, and they also tend to buy item W. So if you purchase books from Amazon, based on your past purchase history, Amazon can use such association rules to generate recommendations for what other items you should or you may want to buy, given that you have expressed an interest in buying or have already bought items X, Y, and Z. So what I'm describing applies not only to the brick and mortar stores like Safeway, but also to the online stores like Amazon. For an online store, it's much easy to use association rules to present the items on the right hand side of the rule to the customer, because they can just display, they can just give a the product description of items V and W on the same page. Whereas for a brick and mortar store, these items have to be physically placed close to the other items that the customer has purchased. So this leads to a slight difference in the way, or a significant difference in the way association rules can be used by brick and mortar stores and online stores. One difference is that online stores may be interested in association rules not just for items that are frequently bought. So X, Y, and Z don't have to be purchased by a huge number of customers for Amazon to recommend other products that customers may be interested in if they've bought X, Y, and Z. Whereas for a brick and mortar store to physically act upon the association rule by locating the other items close to the items that have been purchased, it must be the case that a large number of customers are buying X, Y, and Z. Only then does it make sense for V and W to be placed close to X, Y, and Z, so that there'll be a large number of customers who will probably buy V and W because of that convenience in locating those items in the store. Whereas if X, Y, and Z are purchased together relatively rarely, then even if there is an association rule between X, Y, and Z and V and W, it may not be worth the investment to use such association rules on rare items and act upon them. That may not generate much profit for the brick and mortar store. Of course, for an online store could still generate profit by exploiting association rules between rare items, because there will be a huge number of rare items. So even if the profits for a single rare item or the association rule for a single rare item may not be significant when acted upon, but across all the collections of rare items, which we sometimes call as the long tail, because there are a huge number of items that are rarely bought, but that particular set of items that are bought is large. So there are a huge number of rare items. So the profits on a single rare item may not be significant, but added across all the rare items, the profit can become significant. So for our purposes, we are going to imagine that we are looking primarily at brick and mortar stores. So we are interested in association rules corresponding to frequent item sets, not association rules between item sets that are not frequent. So we are going to adopt a two-step approach, and in the first step we are going to find these frequent item sets, and then in the second step we are going to generate association rules from these frequent item sets. So let's define a frequent item set more formally. We are interested in finding sets of items that appear together frequently in baskets or in transactions. So how do we define the word frequently more rigorously? Well, first let's define something called a support for an item set I. The support for an item set I is just the number of baskets which contain all the items in I. So for example, if there are three items, milk, bread, and coke, in an item set, the support for this item set will be the number of transactions in which all three of these products are bought. So it doesn't, these include not only the transactions in which exactly these three items are bought, but also transactions in which other products could be bought in addition to these three. So as long as these three are present in a particular transaction, that transaction is going to contribute one to the overall score for this item set, which we call as the support. It's just the number of transactions or the number of baskets which contain all the items. Now the support is expressed sometimes as just an integer number, which is just the frequency or the number of transactions containing those items, but it can also be expressed as a fraction or as a percentage of the total number of transactions. So you can guess now how we are going to define a frequent item set. A frequent item set is an item set whose support is higher than some threshold. So we get to define what this threshold should be such that item sets having a support larger than this threshold are going to be called frequent item sets. So if the support threshold is S, then the item sets that appear in at least S transactions are going to be called as frequent item sets. So here's an example of an item set having five items: milk, coke, Pepsi, beer, and juice. And let's say that we define the support threshold to be three baskets. Now this may seem small, but that's because in this example we are only looking at 8 transactions. So these are 8 baskets or 8 transactions, each transaction consisting of a set of items that are purchased in that transaction. So the letters M, C, and B just stand for the first letters of the corresponding items: milk, coke, and beer. Likewise, this transaction, the fourth transaction, is coke, comma, juice. So let's use the definition of a frequent item set that we came up with to determine which of these, which subset of these items would be a frequent item set. Let's consider first the singleton set milk. Is the singleton set milk a frequent item? Yes, because if you look at the items in this set, which is milk, milk appears in 5 out of these 8 transactions. Now 5 is greater than 3, so our support for this set is larger than the support threshold, and so milk is a frequent item set. Likewise, if you look at this item set consisting of 2 items, milk and beer, you may notice that the 4 arrows, the 4 red arrows going to the corresponding transactions, B1, B3, B5 and B6, these are the 4 transactions in which both milk and beer are purchased. And the other transactions lack at least one of these 2 elements. So there are 4 transactions among the 8 which have milk and beer. Now 4 is greater than 3. So the support for this set is larger than the support threshold, and so we define milk and beer as a frequent item set. We classify milk and beer as a frequent item set. Let's look at this example, Coke, juice. This item set appears in 3 of the transactions. 3 is greater than or equal to the support threshold. So we're going to define a frequent item set as an item set whose support is greater than or equal to the support threshold S. Right? So the support threshold for an item set needs to be greater than or equal to S for it to be called a frequent item set. So it should appear in at least S baskets. So even if it appears in exactly S baskets, we're going to call it a frequent item set. So these are the frequent item sets for this data. And I've already mentioned how the frequent item sets can be applied by a supermarket store, can be used by a supermarket store to increase their profits. So the items are the products, and the baskets are the sets of items that are purchased in one trip to the store. And in a real market basket, the chain store is going to keep terabytes of data about what customers buy together across all their stores. So we've already discussed that this can tell them how to position tempting items in the aisles so that customers who are navigating a store can purchase other items based on what they have already purchased or put in their shopping cart. Another way in which this can be exploited by the supermarket store is to come up with some tricky deals. For example, if diapers are frequently purchased with beer, then they can run a sale on diapers and raise the price of beer. Now, firstly, you may ask why would diapers and beers be purchased together? And we saw an example of a rule like that people who tend to purchase diaper and milk also tend to purchase beer in the store. Why is that? Well, it's because if somebody is purchasing milk and diapers at a store, it's very likely that that customer has a small child in his or her home. So most likely those customers don't have the time to go and drink at a bar, and so they purchase beer at the supermarket store to drink at home. And that's something that a particular supermarket store has found, that there is a correlation between purchasing diapers and milk and purchasing beer. So the purchase of diaper and milk tends to be predictive of the purchase of beer to some extent, of course. It's not necessary that all customers who purchase diapers and milk also purchase beer, but there is some correlation. So this can be exploited, therefore, to come up with deals where you reduce the price of one of the items but increase the price of the other item, so that you're not compromising too much, and you can actually increase your profits in this way. Likewise, on Amazon, people who bought a particular item X can also be shown item Y so that Amazon can increase its sales. So if people actually find Y tempting, people who purchased X are likely to find Y tempting to buy, then it's likely that they will actually purchase Y with some probability. And so by presenting Y to those customers, Amazon can increase its sales relative to the scenario where they don't show item Y to those customers.